On December 7, 1941, Japan bombed the U.S. naval base, Pearl Harbor. This unexpected attack scared many U.S. citizens. The following day, December 8, the United States declared war on Japan and its other allies. Soon, anti-Japanese posters popped up all over the country. Some places refused to serve Japanese Americans or even let them in. The government started debating about what to do with all of the Japanese Americans living in the United States. The government debated that if they lived on the West Coast, they could be spies for Japan, threatening U.S. security.
On February 19, 1942, President Franklin Delano Roosevelt issued Executive Order 9066 that told all Japanese that they were to be relocated to wartime relocation centers. The president said they were being relocated for their own protection, but most of the Japanese didn't think that was true. They had until April 2nd to have sold all of their land and to also sell all of their possessions that they couldn't carry with them to the internment camps. The items that they couldn't carry with them had to be left behind.
After they had gone to the places that they were assigned to go to by the military, they were put onto trains with soldiers guarding the nearby area. They were only allowed to take onto the train what they could carry. Then they were shipped off to the relocation centers if they were done, and temporary relocation centers if the actual camps were not yet finished. Some of the internees were taken to Tan Foreign Racetrack, which served as a temporary internment camp, where they lived in horse stalls as the Topaz internment camp was finished.
Once the Topaz internment camp was finished being built on September 11, 1942, the internees living at the Tan Foreign Racetrack were put onto trains once again and transported to Delta, Utah. Once they arrived at the camp, they got off the train, where again guards surrounded the area by where they got off. Most of the barracks were finished, but the schools and some housing barracks were not. Those who were assigned to live in the unfinished barracks had to finish building them themselves.
Topaz internment camp was located 16 miles away from the small city of Delta and was 1 square mile in area. Throughout the war, it interned about 8,000 internees, becoming Utah's 5th largest city. There was a barbed wire fence that ran around the perimeter of the camp, making most of Topaz's internees feel as if it were a prison rather than a camp, regardless of the government telling them that it was for their own protection. The temperatures ranged from about 106 degrees Fahrenheit to negative 30 degrees Fahrenheit. Their living spaces were 16 feet by 20 feet to 20 feet by 25 feet, with 4 to 6 people in each room. If the relocation center was for their protection, why were they relocated to the desert far away from people and cramped into small living quarters?
Living conditions in Topaz were rough and very much like a prison. However, most families were given the chance to stay together, but they were very cramped. Because the barracks were so close together, most residents were kept up at night by others' conversations, complaining children, and crying babies. There was much diplomacy as the internees learned how to live so close together peacefully. There were guards positioned around the camp with their guns facing it. If it was for their protection, shouldn't the guns have been facing outside of the camp to protect them? James Hatsuki Wakasa was a 60-year-old Japanese-American internee at the Topaz internment camp. On April 11, 1943, he was walking by the barbed wire fence. Then he was shot by a guard who said that he shot 2 warning shots. Although he wasn't known by many people, over 2,000 people showed up for his funeral. All throughout Topaz and Delta, people debated about why he was shot to death. Some say he was trying to escape, while others say he was walking his dog, and even some say he was deaf.
The Topaz Museum website described the barracks as coal stoves, heated apartments, but cooking in the residential area was discouraged. Furniture for the apartments included only army cots, mattresses, and blankets. Some residents constructed rough tables and shelves out of scrap lumber left lying around the camp. The barracks, crudely constructed of pine planks, covered with tar paper as the only insulation, and sheetrock on the inside, provided little protection against the extreme weather of the semi-arid climate.
Men and women were allowed to get jobs, but the pay they received for doing so, between $16 and $19 a month for doctors or skilled workers, was less than the pay that Americans received for doing the same job even if they worked in Topaz. Harry Yasadu, who worked for Frank Beckwith, was charged rent for a barrack at the Topaz internment camp. He couldn't live anywhere else, but he was required to pay rent. The internees ate in a mess hall. The food was usually some type of organ meat. They had to stand in line for their food, and when they were done, they had to scrub their own plates and leave the hall. They had to eat when they were told to and sleep when they were told to.
Children had a whole different view of the camp than the adult. At the time of the internment, the children did not realize the pressure that the internment camps held. This was their home, no matter how terrible it seemed. Even though the internees lived in an isolated desert environment, they found entertainment and excitement within the camp. They socialized in the mess hall and sang together. They were given schools, two elementary schools and a high school. But most of their rights were still gone, as if they lived in a prison. The end of the school year would come and they would sign yearbooks. They played sports and went for walks on the roads and read books inside of their barracks. They also built gardens and celebrated holidays. Not everything, though it seemed, was bad in these camps.
The Japanese-American men were given the option to enlist in the army, but first they were questioned on their loyalty. The loyalty questionnaire, as it was called, consisted of two main questions, which were first, are you willing to serve in the armed forces of the United States on combat duty, wherever ordered? The second question was, will you swear unqualified allegiance to the United States of America and faithfully defend the United States from any and all attack by foreign or domestic forces, and forswear any form of allegiance to the Japanese Emperor or any other foreign government, power, or organization? These questions could only be answered in two ways, yes, yes, or no, no. Some people answered no, no. They were called the no, no boys. Those that answered yes, yes, went on to serve in the military.
When the war was over, the Topaz internment camp was closed and the Japanese Americans were released and given transportation to their pre-war cities, even though many didn't have homes and had no possessions. Some of the Japanese Americans decided to stay at the camp for a little while longer because of either not having a home or because the West Coast was still very hostile to Japanese Americans. The government seemed ashamed of the Topaz internment camp and they debated about what to do with it. Eventually, they came to a conclusion and dismantled the dreary camp, removing all of the indications that it had ever happened. The United States government and people did not formally apologize until the year 1991, when President George Bush sent out letters of apology and checks for $2,000 to the surviving internees at the Topaz internment camp. Not all internees accepted, though, as some only wanted a sincere apology.
A number of things can be learned from the debate and the diplomacy involving Japanese internment in the Topaz internment camp. One of the things we can learn from this is that just because people of a race do something wrong doesn't mean that all the people in that race aren't good people. They could even be ashamed of those who did the wrong thing. Another thing is that before we judge people, we should get to know them to see if they really deserve what we think they should. The government also needs to debate more and be more diplomatic when it comes to things like interning people. And think if it is really good for citizens and those being interned. The final one is that if someone who has never been disloyal shouldn't be questioned on his or her loyalty. In the words of Maya Angelou, history, despite its wrenching pain, cannot be unlived, but if faced with courage, need not be lived again.